but a hoard may include thousands or hundreds of thousands of items that are all sellable, some of them completely new in their original packaging. Greetings, fellow human. I'm Rose from happyandauthentic.com, and today's topic is a little bit more sensitive than usual. I was asked by a viewer to talk about the aftermath of hoarding when someone you love passes away and they were a hoarder and you're left cleaning up their mess, quite literally and also very figuratively as well. For those who don't know, hoarding is a disorder that involves really struggling with letting go of things. It's the act of compulsively saving items that other people may view as worthless. People who hoard may really struggle with letting go of possessions as simple as an old newspaper or even used takeout containers. They obsessively hold on to basically everything that comes into their life because they become unable to discern between valuable things and garbage. And they get seriously worked up over the idea of letting anything go. So it's really hard to help those people. That basically means that the only time their loved ones find out about the hoarding or get to do anything about it is after their loved ones die, when they already have to deal with the grief of losing someone they care about and possibly having to organize the funeral arrangements on top of just living their normal life. I want to make it clear that hoarding has been classified as a mental illness, and it often manifests as a symptom of other disorders like OCD, ADHD, and depression. And it's not as rare as you might think. Roughly 160 million people worldwide suffer from hoarding, and it impacts almost everyone they're close to. A person who hoards might not know that they're hoarding. They might have convinced themselves that they're just collecting things, or that they will actually need these things someday. A lot of them are also convinced that their loved ones will be happy to inherit everything they own. Sadly, though, the reality is that most of the time, the people left behind see these items as the junk that they are, and just want to get rid of it as soon as possible. But of course, that is easier said than done. You might assume that all of the stuff in a hoarder's hoard is actual junk, and that you can simply put it all in a dumpster and throw it away and be done with it. But unfortunately, the hoarder had a method to their madness, and they had an organizing system of their own. They knew where everything was, or at least they thought they did. So it's not uncommon for them to have piled really valuable things like actual diamonds and priceless family heirlooms in the same box as old receipts and expired cans of food. So there's simply no way of knowing if a box that looks like it's full of trash actually has something really valuable in it until you actually spend the time to sort through it manually. And depending on how big the hoard is, this can take anywhere from weeks and months to actual years, costing thousands or hundreds of thousands of dollars, not only up front to restore and clean and sort everything, but also indirectly because the loved ones have to take time off work and put their own lives on hold to sort through all of it. On top of all this, if the hoarder rented, the family may only have a couple of weeks or at most a month to clear everything out before the house needs to get rented to somebody else. The alternative is continuing to pay the rent themselves, which they may or may not be able to do financially. If the deceased hoarder owned their own home, that can make it even more complicated because, depending on the size of the house, they may now be faced with many quite large rooms full of piles, like literal mountains, of all this stuff. Not to mention the garage and any storage units that the deceased may have held. This residence needs to be cleared out and disinfected before you can even get started on the repairs. Because make no mistake, hoarding causes a lot of serious damage structurally to the building. It can ruin the walls, the plumbing, the carpets. It may have attracted vermin or even developed toxic mold. This is all very expensive to deal with. And when you're grieving because you've lost someone you love, it becomes so much harder to make the rational decisions necessary to handle all of this. The physical and emotional toll this takes on the people left behind is considerable and not to be dismissed. Not only is there a physical threat, of the hoard becoming contaminated by vermin, like rodents and insects, which can fill the place up with urine and feces or even their own tiny dead bodies. But there's also the possibility of rotten food, human bodily waste, and in some cases, even the dead body of the hoarder themselves, who may have died inside their home and not been discovered for days or weeks. All of this combines to contaminate basically everything inside the home and create a dangerous level of biohazardous material that can seriously impact the health of anyone who comes into contact with the hoard. So whether you deal with this yourself or you seek assistance, it's vitally important that anyone who comes into contact with the contents of the home wears some sort of protective gear, like gloves and a mask at the absolute minimum. Then there's the possibility that depending on where the hoarder lived, their estate might be subject to probate. And if a family member has been appointed as the executor or the administrator of said estate, they then have a legal obligation to make sure nothing of value is lost. Which means they can't just chuck out everything and wipe their hands of it. A detailed accounting and inventory of the deceased person's assets must be taken first, which can only be done if you thoroughly, physically process everything inside the hoard before cleanup. In most cases, since the residence itself is likely the most valuable asset owned, the house must legally be returned to a habitable condition. This means you not only have to remove all of the hoarded items, but you also need to clean and disinfect the remaining home, as well as restore any structural or sometimes even cosmetic damage caused to the premises. The hoarding itself of all the items, plus the neglect that came as a result of having so much, can both damage everything else within the home and ruin the building itself. Like I said, carpets might be completely ruined and need to be redone. Curtains, walls, plumbing, furniture, doors, windows, sometimes even the very foundations of the home need to be completely redone. This not only is possibly going to cost hundreds of thousands of dollars, but also takes up a considerable amount of time and physical labor. Going through just one of those things is bad enough, but going through all of them at the same time as grieving a loved one can be completely impossible for most people. So I'm going to start by saying that if you have the financial means to do so, I would definitely recommend hiring a professional to help you. There are many different avenues for this, which I will mention in as much detail as I can in just a moment. But before I provide specific examples, I'd like to talk about the emotional aspect for a bit. Walking into the house of a deceased hoarder is going to cause a considerable amount of stress and anxiety, no matter who you are. You're likely going to be grief-stricken at the loss of your loved one, have to sort out funeral arrangements for them, and also juggle the regular things that you do in your life, like your job and your family responsibilities, all while taking care of your own health. And now on top of all that, you also have to handle the already overwhelming task of clearing out your loved one's items. It could possibly be millions of items. You may even put your own life on hold to handle all of this, which then makes grieving a lot harder. And this is if you already knew about the hoarding. If the person in your life who was hoarding kept it from the people around them, this may be your first time even finding out about it. And if you're not familiar with this sort of thing, it can really trigger you and be very traumatic. The stench alone can overwhelm you when you step inside a hoarder's home. Then you get overwhelmed with all these emotions that can be very confusing. You may experience a large amount of guilt over not being able to help your family member overcome their hoarding while they were still alive. You might experience shame that someone so close to you was hoarding at all and was living in such a state. You might be angry at the fact that they left this mess for you to clean up. Any and all emotions could surface, sometimes all at once, surprising and overwhelming you to the point that you might be tempted to not do anything about it. It being both the hoard and the emotions. You might just let the hoard sit there unattended for ages because you don't know where to start. And you might bury your emotions because you think they're getting in the way. So what I would recommend as a first step in all of this is to break down everything into three very general main categories to clear up in your head the order in which you're going to do everything. And then from that point on, separate those categories into smaller, more manageable steps. So the three general categories, in the order that I recommend you do them, are: one, to allow yourself to process your emotions mindfully and authentically; two, to sort the hoarded items; and three, to restore the property. Don't try to do everything all at once, because it is a lot to handle and it can be very confusing. So let's start with step one. The most important thing is to recognize that this is a very difficult situation to go through, and it's okay to feel however you feel about it. Accept that you feel sad or angry or alone or guilty, and accept that you're grieving right now. Let yourself do so. If you don't have to rush with dealing with the hoard right now, don't do it. You don't have to. You can give yourself the time you need to grieve their death and feel like you're up to it before getting started. If the deceased was renting and there is a time limit, then you either have to accept that and try to do your best with it, or ask for help in extending the time that you have by paying the rent or talking to the people who own the place. The worst that could happen is that they say no and you have to deal with it, but asking is very important because sometimes you do get what you ask for, and there's no shame in that. You can even get someone you know and trust to ask for you if you're not up for it right now. It's okay to let people support you. It doesn't mean you're weak or useless or anything like that. And no matter what you choose to do and what the situation is like, I definitely recommend getting the help of a therapist. Talking to friends and family can really help, and that is amazing if you have that kind of support. But talking to a licensed psychologist, especially if you can find someone who specializes in families of hoarders, is going to help you so much more. There are a number of very affordable and sometimes even completely free options out there for support of this kind, either in person or online. As I don't know where you live, I can't give you specific instructions that are going to work for you 100%, but I'm going to do my best to offer as much support as I can for the most amount of people that I can in the description below. Also, please accept that this step is going to take a different amount of time for each person, because we all process emotions in our own way. Just remember that you don't have to feel 100% okay with everything before you start tackling the hoard. You will still experience emotional grief over losing your loved one. You will still go through a lot of overwhelming emotions when you tackle the hoard. Clearing things out is going to bring up a lot of trauma and turmoil, so just please be prepared for that. It doesn't mean you're not ready to get to that step, it just means it's going to be hard and you're going to need support. It may be easier for you if you enlist the help of friends and family, not just for the physical assistance they can provide, but mostly for the emotional support. Or it might feel better for you to be alone in this and not have people there to witness how you deal with your grief. You're the only person who really knows yourself, so just accept whatever's there for you. Don't work against it. What I mean by being mindful and authentic is really look for what's there. Really notice how you feel and why you feel that way, and try to do the things that feel natural. Don't second guess yourself and don't judge it. Step two, clearing everything out, is going to be gruesome, but you don't have to do it alone. If you need to enlist help, that is completely okay. If you can afford to, hire a professional, someone who specializes in clearing out hoarded homes. Even if you can only hire them to help you with a portion of the house, some help is still way better than no help. They've done this before and they can provide you with valuable tips on top of their physical help. Simply provide them with a list of the sort of items you'd want them to set aside for you, and they will handle the rest. They know how each type of item should be disposed of, and they have the tools to do it quickly. Then you have the time and space to sift through the items they've set aside for you, which can make it much easier to find valuable items like family heirlooms or birth certificates. You can make the cost of hiring a service like this a lot easier to bear by starting a GoFundMe page and raising the funds amongst the people you know. Or you can split the cost directly with your friends and family. If after trying everything, hiring a professional is just not in the cards for you, at least enlist the help of your friends and family to help you with the physical labor and make the burden lighter. even if you are the hoarder's only living relative. You don't have to do this alone. You have a support system of people who love you. So ask them for help. Even if they can only offer just a few hours of their time, it will still be a massive help. So don't feel bad about asking. Of course, I would be remiss if I didn't let you know that there is another option that may not be the best option for everybody, but regardless, it is available and it might work for you. As outrageous as it might sound, some people are willing to purchase the house of a hoarder as is. Yeah, with the hoard still inside. Check out sites like auction.com and hoarderhomes.com to see whether this would be an option for you. If the possible valuables you might find inside the home just simply aren't worth the effort and heartache, and the prospect of going through the hoard yourself seems like too much for you, then selling the house as it is might be a good idea. So perhaps look into it. Also, if the deceased had home insurance, contact them, because they might pay to clean up any damage caused from the unattended body, along with any damages to the house when removing your loved one. You never know what's covered until you ask, so ask. Also, try your best to figure out if your loved one had a will, because it might contain specific instructions on what to do with their possessions. Once you've gone through all of your options, you'll reach a point where you can no longer put off cleaning everything up. So take a moment to compose yourself and try your best to look at this as logically as possible. I know that that is way easier said than done when we're talking about someone you love that died. But let me try to explain. It's extremely common for those left behind to take a leave of absence from their job because cleaning the house of a hoarder can take months. This not only means they're not making as much money or perhaps any money, they're actively spending money trying to handle all of this, and they're in a compromised mental state due to the emotional turmoil. It's very, very easy at that point for their loved one's hoarding to become their own, as they struggle to let go of the last remaining items they have to remember that person by. They may not have wanted any of this stuff to begin with, but when faced with the prospect of throwing something away that meant a lot to the person they loved, it may feel like betraying their memory. As they go, they might find things that remind them of their family member, and it feels wrong to simply throw it in the trash, because it feels like throwing away a piece of them. It can feel very strongly like letting go of these items is the same as letting go of this person's memory. At this point, it becomes necessary to acknowledge and reject your own hoarding tendencies before the pull becomes too strong. You may not suffer from the same disorder as your family member, but it can be very, very easy to just hold on to these items and postpone letting them go. The longer you stay amongst the hoard, the harder it becomes to tell what's valuable and what's trash. The hoarder may have stored literal diamonds amongst expired cans of food, so you might become paranoid that you might throw out something of real value by accident. And a lot of the time, the response to this is to not throw anything away. It's not uncommon for people to go through these items and find things of actual value that they can then sell to recover some of the costs of going through the hoard and disposing of the actual junk. Since a typical cleanup could cost anywhere between $1,000 and $20,000, and sometimes even more, a lot of people start desperately sifting through it all, hoping to one day come upon buried treasure. But time is also a factor here, and we shouldn't forget that. Not only are you losing precious time from your life that you could be spending with your other loved ones, you're also missing out on time you could be making money yourself rather than spending it on the hoard. If you're missing out on work, or you're spending more money than you're recovering, it might be time to cut your losses and cast everything into two extremely rough piles. The keep pile and the throwaway pile. Everything in the throwaway pile needs to go straight away. It goes in the bin or the dumpster or the truck, whatever you're using to take it to wherever garbage goes, but it does not get looked at again. You're not going to sell any of it. You're not going to keep any of it. You're not going to donate any of it. This is actual trash. Used napkins, old newspapers, receipts that have expired, cardboard boxes that have melted away to nothing, and items that are broken beyond repair. Once it's put in the throwaway pile, it needs to get thrown out. Don't let it sit there. Don't give yourself any time to second guess yourself. Just get rid of it as quickly as possible. Then it's time to look at the items in the keep pile. This doesn't mean you're personally keeping everything. It means these are the things that can be salvaged. Either they are important enough that you actually need to keep them, like family photos, heirlooms, jewelry, certificates, that sort of thing. Or they are items that can retain their value enough to be resold or donated. These items can be subject to the same minimalist principles and practices as items you already own. Can you simply take a picture of it to remember that person by and then let it go? Can you restore it? And if you do, is it something you're going to keep and actually use, or is it something you're going to sell to recover your costs? If you are going to sell it, I need to make something really, really clear to you right now. The stuff you want to sell is not going to go for what you expect it to. You're not going to get paid what it's actually worth. So let go of that idea right now, because it's going to cost you if you don't. I know it feels like you're losing money when you don't get what you think you deserve for an item. But try to remember that none of this cost you anything to receive. You were left these items. Someone else purchased them. Holding on to these items is going to cost you. So letting them go for as much as you can get for them, accepting that, and moving on is the absolute best case scenario. I know a lot of people are tempted to hold on to things that they think are going to fetch a nice price, and they think they're going to put them on eBay, Amazon, or Craigslist and sell them separately to everything else. But this quadruples the amount of time and effort you need to make to go through everything. You have to see if it's fit to sell, restore it if it isn't, take pictures of it, post those pictures online and create the post, possibly in several different places, and then either mail it to the buyer or be there for the pickup. That's all fine and dandy when we're talking about 10 or 20 items, but a hoard may include thousands or hundreds of thousands of items that are all sellable. Some of them completely new in their original packaging, never opened. Selling them could be a full-time job. So what happens most often is people just don't have time to do this. So these items just sit there in a pile, stay completely unattended to for ages before the family realizes they're hoarding them too. Do yourself a favor and take the easy way out here. Only create listings for the really big stuff, big ticket items like furniture or cars. Put everything else into the garage or onto the yard and have a garage sale or a yard sale. I know it's hard to see something that costs $300 go for just $5, but hey, this way you're letting go of a lot of this stuff way more quickly. You don't have to put in the effort to take it anywhere yourself. You're giving it a new lease on life, saving it from the trash heap, and this money adds up. You have a lot of items now. These, even if they only go for a few dollars each, it's gonna end up being a considerable amount of money. And at the end of the yard sale, you need to remember that some things just aren't going to sell. Just because you think it should sell and it's valuable enough to, doesn't mean it's gonna. If there isn't anyone interested in buying it, you may have to accept that you're gonna have to donate it. Giving it away to Goodwill for free is still way better than throwing it away. You're helping the environment. You're giving someone else a chance to own this item who wouldn't have been able to afford it otherwise. And you may not even have to take these items to the thrift store yourself. Some places, like the Salvation Army, will come to your home and pick them up. So call ahead and ask. Do your research for your local area and the charity stores that are there, because you never know. And of course, throughout this entire process, emotions may begin to bubble up again at this point. Let them. Perhaps you feel regret at all the wasted money, or you might harbor vague notions that your loved one could have made this a lot easier on you if only they'd accepted help and tackled their own hoard themselves while they were alive. All these emotions are natural, and it's okay to experience them. Don't beat yourself up about it. You're not a bad person for thinking any of this. To make this a little easier, if you are enlisting the help of anybody at all, whether hired or free by friends and family, give them a copy of the list that you made of the most important items that you want them to look out for. So while they're going through this, they have a better idea of what should go into the trash pile and what should go into the keep box. If they find photographs, jewelry, certificates, give them a designated space to put it all, like a large container, or even just a laid out sheet in the middle of the house. That way they're easier, they're all in one space, and you can quickly sort through them later yourself. Once the house has been cleared of all the items, it then becomes time to clean the house. And I mean properly decontaminate all surfaces. Even if it looks clean, chances are there's a lot of bacteria all over it. Once everything is clean, then you may need to start rebuilding broken portions of the home and try your best to renovate or restore it to a livable standard. Whether you're selling the house or you're going to live in it yourself, you're gonna need to do all this. So again, ask for or hire help if it's within your means. You'd be surprised how healing it is to see the house of your loved one restored to a livable condition. It kind of gives you a sense that you've restored dignity to that person, even if it was post-mortem. And remember to allow yourself enough time to heal from this traumatic event, because it definitely was a traumatic event. Take care of yourself and don't beat yourself up. It may even be helpful for you to seek out support groups. You're not alone. There are millions of people out there who are in a similar position to you. They know what you're going through. Simply getting in touch with each other can really help you both heal and grow. And talking about it can be a huge weight off your shoulders. Not to mention, you can get tips from each other. Now, I know I haven't gone through everything in as much detail as I could have, but if there is anything you believe I've left out and would like me to talk about in another video, just let me know in the comments below. I'm doing my best to be as thorough as possible, but this video is already huge, much longer than I wanted it to be, and I don't want it to become unwieldy because I want the information to still be usable. If you watched this far into the video and you thought the information was clear and useful, please give it a thumbs up and let me know, because that's the only way I'm gonna learn and be able to improve my content in the future. If you like this sort of content and you wanna make sure you don't miss any of my future videos, you can subscribe. If you'd like to support the channel, you can go have a look on Patreon. I offer a number of perks there that you can check out, including discount codes for my programs and things like that, and coaching. Speaking of coaching, if you're interested in a more personal approach to minimalism or even dealing with hoarding, just go to happyandauthentic.com and book your first session completely free so we can get to know each other and see if we're a good fit together. But whatever you decide, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you when I see you. And I'll just take a moment to thank my patrons, Eric Gendez, Anne-Marie Sands, Dawn Rivers, Lizmar Santiago, Tanya Danilenko, and Tim Farness. These videos would not be possible without you. I am extremely grateful for your support and hope you enjoy the content you're receiving.